We have available for nanomaterial characterization a big amount of techniques as laser, nanotechnology, physical properties, synthesis, optics, spectroscopy, material characterization and analysis. I tried to be quite fast as possible because it's quite a big amount of techniques that we have available. And so we are representing several brands. We start with X-ray diffraction from Proto. After that, we have no ambient X-ray diffraction and SACS from Anton Parr, and as well from Anton Parr, atomic force microscopy. And from Renishaw, it's another partner that is Raman spectroscopy. Let's start with proto diffraction, let's say. Proto, it's a scientific instrument manufacturer specialized in X-ray diffraction instruments for laser, for material characterization, quality control, and scientific research. I have a customer base over 400 systems installed around the world. Number of industries like automotive, aerospace, power generation, marines, military, and so on, and university as well. Proto have a contract measuring laboratories in the around the world, and it's possible to request measurements on your laboratories. So the range of products, I think this is quite important to understand a little bit. We have, let's say, quite broad range of the instrumentation. We have residual stress, power diffraction, low orientation, and X-ray source available. So this is maybe for some of you already know what is residual stress, but this is a workshop, maybe some people it's starting. So it's the internal stress distribution locked in the material present, even after all external loading forces have been removed. So our systems or residual stress systems are designed with property position sensitive scintillation detectors and in-house tubes. So this is our, systems available for, the residual stress. We have standard, we have assembled quite broad range of instrumentation for these specific measurements. And also we have a low, as we said before, diffraction, low diffraction. So to determine the orientation of a crystal, utilize a collimated white beam of polymetric X-ray and collect the diffracted image onto a 2D X-ray detector. Pattern of reflection correspond to the orientation and structure of the crystal. The application, it's a single crystal turbine blades for using gas as an example. The product of portfolio, it's these three different for low cost, HD and HDR. And for power diffraction, we have as well, as I mentioned, it's for material identification, the phase ID, no ambient condition, temperature, humidity, stability, and this is the main, the main instruments available for this. Of course, if you want to have more details after we discuss, but the idea is to present more applications than the instrumentation itself. So we have a high resolution X-ray diffraction as well. This is for characterized epitaxial thin films like semiconductor device, determine the perfection of single crystal material in silicon devices, radiation detectors, and analyze the thin layers and thickness. So as I mentioned, we have made or Proto made in-house X-ray tube manufacturer. It's possible to choose the beam geometry like spot or line, different sizes, and different anode materials like copper and cobalt, and some of them are available. We have also a dedicated software with for different instruments, have different, features. Depending the one, we have the feature available. Okay, let's start with maybe some more exciting things. The no ambient X-ray diffraction from Anton Parr. The history of X-ray based activities from Anton Parr is quite long. After established the company in 1922 as locksmith shop and manufacturer of gauges and precision appliance since the 1940, the first scientific instrument of Anton Parr was the world famous Kratty X-ray camera for small angle X-ray sketching. The first temperature chamber of X-ray diffraction followed in 1964. So since then, a huge portfolio of different stages has been developed for studies in high and low temperature regimes, different atmospheres, pressures, humidity, mechanical stress. And in 2001, a further milestone was set with development of the first heating attachment for cycloniometer. The last huge step was done with the first commercial available set of heating and cooling stages dedicated for benchtop diffractometers. So, greatly simplified, in the standard or ambient X-ray diffraction, we investigate mainly crystalline materials. It is a non-destructive measurement method using X-ray in diffraction at different energies to investigate material properties. A measurement result in diffractogram or diffraction pattern, which gives us information of the sample quality and quantitative. So, on now, non-ambient X-ray diffraction has become an indispensable technique to understand the behavior of material under known conditions. Besides, it's relevant for the conducting research. This acknowledgement is essential for optimized technical process and performing quality control in the industry. The principal information content of the diffractogram remains the same, but changing external parameters during the non-ambient experiments add another dimension of information to the experience. The most common changes parameters are temperature, pressure, mechanic load, gas environment or atmosphere, electric fields, relative humidity, and others like magnetic fields. When exposed to sample materials to non-ambient conditions, this may have major influence on crystalline structure composition. More generally spoken, the chemical and physical properties may significantly change under non-ambient conditions, which frequently leads to a completely different behavior of the materials. Due to these elaborate studies have to perform in order to understand the material properties of the complete range of possible non-ambient conditions. The early mentioned non-ambient parameters may cause a variety of material change that can be investigated in situ. Some of them are listed here. Material formation and structure change, alloys, building materials, drugs, APIs, catalysts, minerals, and much more. Annealing to the heat treatment. Alloys, ceramics, and so on, calcium and sintering catalyst, MOF, cellulites, and some others. When performing a measurement, there are two different strategies for data collection. This is more or less the explanation. In the temperature dependent, the X-ray diffraction measure, the main goal is to investigate the influence of temperature on the structure of the sample. For example, when looking for a phase transition temperature, the different necessary steps for this type of measurements are the heating steps, the cooling steps, the hold time, and the measurements. During the heating and the cooling steps, the temperature is adjusted to a temperature set point, applying a certain heating rate to find a phase transition temperature. The optimal heating rate is mainly defined by the temperature difference between initial and final temperature value of the step. It makes no sense to apply very fast heating rates for small temperature steps. For bigger temperature steps, faster heater rates can be applied to save time. This can be done, for example, in the first heating step to get close to the phase transition temperature. If it is known that the phase transition should be observed around 300 degrees, it no makes sense to scan from room temperature to what 300 degrees in steps of five. Instead, it is good strategy to apply big temperature step with fast heating rate to about 290 degrees, followed by a small temperature steps of 2 degrees with the moderate heating of heating rate of 1 degree per minute until the phase transition is observed. The hold time is an optional step before performing the measurements and give the sample time to equilibrate at the fine temperature set point. The length of the hold time depends mainly on the heating cooling rate that was applied. The thermal properties of sample and the heater time behind was in general, longer hold times are required for faster heating rate samples with poor thermal properties and measurements with direct heaters. Typical values of the hold time are ranging from 1 to 5 minutes. The measurements after reaching the set point and eventually applying a hold time allows the necessary data to collect it. Measurement range, step size, and collection time depends on the aim of the investigation for phase and transition studies. The time-dependent measurements is similar, same principal steps in non-ambient experience are described for temperature-dependent measurements, also apply for time-dependent measurements. However, the actual experiments is carried out in a different way because the influence of example temperature on the study in function of time. A typical setup for a non-ambient X-ray diffraction contain not only the diffractometer and no ambient attachment, but also a control unit and control PC, as well as gas line, vacuum equipment, cooling water lines, etc. Depending on the experiment setup, for the optimal solutions, all of these components should be connected with optimal automated remote control. The most important variables for no ambient X-ray experience is the temperature, since it is a major impact of the crystal structure of many materials. As most non-ambient attachments contain a heater, according to the design of the heater, we can distinguish between environment and direct heater. This table summarizes the advantage and disadvantage of both the heaters. Like the environment heaters, we have good temperature homogeneity, and more accurate sample temperature, easy sample exchange reaction in sample holder, and specimen can be avoided using inert sample holder material, sample spinning possible. And some advantage for direct heaters are very high temperature possible, very fast heating, cooling, simple design combination. Of course, we have also disadvantage from the environment heaters, sample holder expansion, for example, slower heating, cooling rates, decrease upper for the limits. Disadvantage for direct heaters are sample preparation, difficult to strip heaters, less sample temperature uniformity, high sample temperature deviation, and reaction between sample and all the possible. So in the last section, I would like to brief introduce the non-ambient X-ray diffraction attachment portfolio from Anton Parr. As the market leader, we provide the widest portfolio with the following overall specification. Here we have the temperature, the humidity, the gas, the pressure, the mechanical load, and the electrical load. For sure, one chamber cannot meet all these specific requirements, but also when evaluating the best choice for your experience, a detailed description of maybe help. So our chamber fit all, this is also important that all our chambers fit all the commercial diffractometers on the market with the appropriate adapter. We can serve standard lab size diffractometers and have chambers for 2 and 4 cycle goniometers. Further, we also have chambers for benchtop diffractometers. All of our chambers may be also integrated in synchrotron beam lines. For use, easy of use, the attachment can be fully integrated in the software and the hardware for remote control. This is the attachments that looks like, for example, the temperature, and here we have the 4 cycle goniometers, 2 cycle. So this is the picture, the shape. In this, it's a summary of the no ambient. It's the summary for that, and it's defined for every variety of application field to get information on materials properties, which may strongly depend on the parameters like temperature and humidity, as mentioned already before. It is vital not only to select the best fitting instrument setup of your experiment, but for aspects like sample weight and temperature validation need to be considered for optimized data quality. And the widest non-ambient range on the market, Anton Parr provide highest quality non-ambient X-ray attachments for lab size and benchtop diffractometers, but also synchrotron facilities. So On the next slide, I would like to go to talk a bit about the SACS experiment, let's say more in the application point of view. We have the small angle X-ray sketching two instruments. We have SACS 0.5 and SACS point space. And the application covered by the SACS 0.5, it's on zinc films, porous materials, nanoparticle dispersion, and polymer fibers. So the the motivation for this, let's say, this example, it's resolving very large nanostructure by SACS, and the diameter more than 340 nanometers, and it requires sketching data at very low angles. The challenge is measuring high resolution SACS data in short time, require high quality and design of the instrument, and it's been performing components, X-ray source, optics, and collimation. So the example, it's the silicon oxide spheres, and we performed the experiment and the results with high resolution SACS measurements with the silicon powder, and the explosion time as shown here. And the pronounced minima in the sketching curve related, and here the curve, relate to the form factor of ion dispersed particles. A second length scale corresponds to the shell thickness of the all of the spheres. So, and here with the first unusual data point and 0.012 nanometer lens one, a fit function was used to evaluate and determine the particle size and the shell thickness of the silicon science spheres, and the particle diameter 232 nanometers, and the shell thickness is 15.4 nanometers. So the next example of this study, it's the zeolite that can exhibit an enormous internal surface area. Therefore, they are used as catalyst, molecular sieves, and the many other applications. Why we use the SACS? The performance and selectivity of zeolites is directly linked to their internal structure and geometry. Combined SACS and WOX is the ideal tool to characterize such material. So, the zeolite powder sample in dry and wet sample was measured in transmission SACS in order to determine the structure and the difference. The results, the 2D scattered patterns, SACS and SOX, both of dry and wet samples are shown in the right. This is the, in the right, it's the pictures. So, the SACS key plot of the wet sample exhibit two correlation peaks. The day spacing values are 25 nanometers first peak and 15 nanometers the second peak. The dry sample exhibit no peaks. The wax key plot revealed double peak for the wet sample. Water penetrate the zeolite on its cell and possible form a sulfate. The wet sample shows a shift to small 2 theta values indicate growth of the on its cell due to the incorporate water. So the next example, it's an example of grazing incidence SACS and the grazing, why motivation for the grazing incidence SACS probes the nanostructure of surface and surface near areas of the zinc film samples. G-SACS gives average results of large samples area providing value structural information complementary to other surface techniques like electron microscope, like the presentation before, and atomic force microscope as well. So the example, it's a layer mesopore thin films on silicon substrate. The GSAC study of layer mesopore thin film sample with the incident angle of 0.2 degrees. And the results, it's the 2D GSAC pattern is several pronounced reflection, the first order and high orders, corresponding to a cubic mesophase structure. The next example is silicon nanostructures, and we are using also G-SACS to study the silicon nanostructure obtained by ion beam pattern. The result is the multi-pronounced lateral reflection indicated high order arrangement of the surface. The disk space of the silicon, this is more or less the information that we get from this. And also another example, it's the morphology of gold nanoparticles. It's also another application that, as you can see, And we get, for example, the results, the SACs after the analysis, the basic data and correction and prosection that export of born again. And we achieve the diameter of cold nanoparticles 6 nanometers and the latex constant of 8 nanometers. So the also it's possible to study the G-SACs heating studies, the morphology cells change of self-assembled gold nanoparticles. And with this instrument, so the results of the experimental, it's the temperature-dependent G-SAC study of gold nanoparticles model incident. We are using the alpha 0.2 and the temperature around 220 degrees. And the morphology strands are observed with increased temperature, hexagonal closed package. Packet arrangement from null to from ambient to 180 degrees and the lattice constant 8 nanometer. Above 190 degrees, the hexagonal closed packet arrangement changed to large structure of 70 nanometers. So this is another instrument. It's the SAC space, and this is more for application in pharma and in proteins. I think this is not the main field of this, let's say, workshop, but this is just to have an idea on the same, let's say, gold nanoparticles in toluene. We are able to, we have some application work on this, and if someone is interested on this subject, please come to me and we are able to share this information and this, let's say, this application note. Also, on quantum dots, we have also a possibility to provide application, or we have application work on this field as well. So for size, to measure size and shape of the particles. And also for SACs, we have combined and complementary methods as well. We combine SACs with FM, DLS, with rheology. So we have several, let's say, combination of SACs, some more, and in this case, this application, it's SACs and FEM for polymeric drug coatings. Let's say this is for biomedical applications, and to perform or to study the adhesion or the drug delivery, the system to the patient, and to understand how it works, let's say. And here it's the results of the FM image from the, let's say, the sample, and also the SACs results given by G-SACs. And the pattern for the drugs of and the thickness for femifield show clear difference. And it's possible to have, let's say, the combination and the correlation between the two results. So the next step is the FM from Anton Parr. This is a talk about the TOSCA. That TOSCA stands for Premio Technology combined with time-efficient, user-friendly operation and automation. Features the powerful software from Anton Parr that its long experience as the developer, producer, and distributor of high accurate analytical instruments for the industry and come together in the peak performance IFM. The high degree of automation and workflow-oriented control and analysis software are integral element on the every level of operation, decreasing your time to results and simplifying the overall handling of IFM measurements. This is a really very easy to use instrument. And for example, start for the cantilever, there are many different cantilevers and brands on the market. TOSCA allow you to use your favorite one. Just put the actuator body and the cantilever into the cantilever exchange tool, slide it back and find it in the cantilever of your choice in an optical position for your next measurement. There is no need to use tweezers for positioning the tiny cantilever in the position anymore. You now have a perfect tool for fast and safe cantilever exchange. For some instruments on the market, the user needs to handle the entire instrument head. On this, it's not necessary. It's the actuator bar. It's very easy to remove and to place on the exchanger cantilever. A very important but also complex step when performing FEM measurements is the laser alignment. This can be quite time consuming, not only but experience for for inexperienced users. Therefore, Tosca provides a full automatic laser alignment function, and after loading the cantilever onto the actuator body and the actuator body onto FM head, the instrument carries out the laser alignment automatically after just two clicks in the software. So this is a new magnetic lock for sample carrier. So it's very stable and very useful when you put the samples. Principle when you have multiple samples and that it's possible to put in multiple sample place in the platform. Once the navigation and measurements are performed without further sample handling or opening the instrument, this is just everything automation on the instrument. The XY scan range up to 100 micron cover a wide range of application. The XY scan location can be regulated very easy by the click and move navigation of Tosca control software. A great position and scanning of your sample is guaranteed. With a Z range of 15 micrometer, it is possible to acquire surface topography in such an XY area and perform a robustness analysis on just a large Z scale. With the decoupled XY and Z scanner at Qchattel, the XY scanner is placed on the sample, while the Z scanner is placed in the instrument head. This instrument design leads to a very low crosstalk between the scanners and very low out-of-plane motion, which is a no drawback of conventional FM systems with a tube scanner, which leads to the typical background curve of our wall. The Tosca series has out-of-plane motion up to 20 times lower than available tube scanner FMs. The engage procedure brings the sample surface to contact with the cantilever. This is one of the most complex procedure when operating an FM. Tosca 400 overcome this problem by implementing a side view camera. With the camera, you can track the exact position of the cantilever with regards to the surface and move the cantilever across the surface. Then you can start automatic engagement procedure in the software, and with seconds, this cantilever touches the surface of the sample and it's ready for scanning. After loading and initialize the software, you can start an overview image of the whole sample table with only one mouse click on the desired position inside the overview image. The instrument navigates the sample to the area of choice for the next measurement. This navigation is also available in the micro view. The navigation is triggered fully automatically by clicking into the piece picture of the integrated video microscope. In this way, you can even navigate to small features very easily. Then here it's let's say the oriented workflow software. It's more or less the picture of the software. It's all the details. It's the parameters, the image, the data, and so on. Everything it's on the one page, and the software for analysis. It's here. It's a wide range of analysis possible for nanostructure geometries and roughness. Or this is a possible automation and in any instrument. So now it's maybe for more interesting things is the application. This is example. This is application report for with the Tosca 400 to characterize aluminium nanoparticles deposited in the indium tin oxide. ETO coated glass using lift off base vapor deposition with electron beam lithography. The nanoparticle patterns were imaged by Tosca 400 in tapping mode. This is the picture it shown here. Another example, it's the nano indentation has been widely used to study the mechanical properties of small volumes of material hardness and elastic model different commercial identifiers. So this is an example of the tip and measure the 3D indentation process in the material. Another example in this report, it's on silicon carbide. It's the sample and show the atomic steps in sub-nanometer range image at three different locations where the taken with Tosca at ambient conditions. The next example, it's using a thin layer of used for chip fabrication. This is for fabrication chip, and it's possible to record the image and its high resolution in both lateral and vertical direction. And this is an ideal tool for chip manufacturing material, the surface roughness of thin film and ensure the quality during the chip fabrication. This is polymer blender. It's another blends. It's another application. And here we introduce the mechanical mode called the contact resonance amplitude imaging. And this is the result of this. If you, of course, as I said, I try to be faster, but if you want to get information about these measurements or experience, please go to me. On this image, it's magnetic properties. On the left side, you see a measurement of our demo sample for magnetic force microscopy mode. The sample consists of a so-called duplex steel, which is what used for its high strength and high corrosion resistance. So this is the image that we get from our instrument. So the next example, it's electrical properties. This conductivity. This is a thick film resistor for surface mount technology and produced in billions every year, induce almost every electronic device on the planet. So this is more it's the what we get. I think I need to go a little bit faster because I need to show something about Raman. So this is another example of electric properties. And now we go to Raman technology. Let's say we are working for this field in the confocal Raman microscope with Reni Shaw. So who don't know much about Raman, basically Raman is a non-destructive and it's flexible sampling at any phase, any size, no preparation, no sample preparation. So it's very good technique if you have some samples that you don't want to destroy. And it's very important for, let's say, bio samples or for some transparent samples as well. It's good to use this kind of technique for Raman. Of course, we have good things and weakness of Raman. Normally, it's a destructive sample if the laser power is higher. And normally the process, it's a weaker scattering, so the signal is not so high normally. And normally the image, it's the weak scatters. We have slow imaging and the spatial resolution is limited by the optics. So we have this kind of limitation more or less. So Raman, it's let's say the technology that we, or the technique that it's able to make the composition, let's say identification of the composition. It's able to make stress strain state, crystal symmetry and orientation, quality of the crystal, amount of material and the temperature dependence. So it's quite useful for this kind of subjects. The kind of application, it's a lot. We cover a lot of application from SARS, for surface Raman sketching, for bio-Raman, for forensic as well. We are, let's say, broad range of application from chemistry, petrochemical, catalyst, pharmaceutical, polymer science, material science, more in your the field of this workshop, maybe polymer and material science. It's the fields, and also in the earth science, photovoltaic, semiconductor, and carbon. This is already talked before in the presentation about the carbon, so we are able to perform characterization of on this, let's say, sample. Here we have, I have, let's say, application, some work done on carbon. This is a Raman spectra and photoluminescence spectroscopy of polycrystalline CVD diamond. So this is the spectra that we are able to get from the instrument. And the carbon also, it's possible to measure or to understand the stress in the diamond film, for example. And the carbon nanotubes, also we are able to make characterization of them. And the size is not able to show the true size, but it's possible to calculate them from the radial reading mode. So this is something on graphene samples, also graphene. We are able to measure or to make the characterization of this, let's say, material. It's very sensitive, and it's possible to determine the shape of 2D band, reduce the number of the graphene layer, for example. This is one of the application. Again, it's graphene example. I think I'm very close to the end. And the carbon graphene example, again, it's the optical image. And this is a single and multiple graphene layer by Raman. This is a G-band area, and here it's a G-band in total shift range of 5.2 centimeters -1, and two-layer graphene defect effect. So this is another example on coatings as well. This is a nice application on the last feature of the confocal Raman. It's a live track. This means that this is a screwdriver with the coating, and we are able to perform, let's say, the shape of the screwdriver, that it's say microscopic, but we are able to perform, let's say, the composition of the Raman image of the screwdriver from the macro to micro, let's say, micro scale identification, and to understand how the coating is good, or what is the, for example, different kind of coatings and so on. And from polymer, this is very high sensitive technology or technique to specific for polymers. So we are able to distinguish the different kind of polymers. Of course, we are able to distinguish them. So it's possible to map an image and to understand the, let's say, the difference between them, and where is the defect, and so on. For example, here it's the example of the phase change. For example, we are increase the temperature, and we see when the sample melt and when the sample contract. So it's we are able to change the temperature and to follow what is the state of what is the Raman. It's possible to get the information about the real let's say the state of the material as well. We have used this with the live track that it was called before, because if you have a melt sample, the focus change, and we need to track the focus position. And this is the polymer information with the phase, the bands, and the orthodontic bands, so we are able to follow, let's say, the phase of the materials. So another big example that it's coming quite soon now, and it's a high topic, this is microplastics in water, for example. On this, we are able to analyze the microplastics. We are able to measure the size, we are able to understand what is the chemical composition, already talked, and let's say with the software, we are able to make the quantification of number of these kind of plastics, or let's say to make the statistic of this. So this is some important tools for the next few, let's say, years, I think, to understand the more about microplastics and why it's found. So another example here, it's a very short description. It's for the lithium ion batteries, the positive anode. But we are, for example, the impurities, or for example, the next step, it's the image, and we are able to see where is the degradation. For example, the blue area, it's where the electrodes are degradations, and we are able to see where is the degradation. And here again, the lithium-ion battery, and this is on biomaterials as well. So we have some application on the bonds, for example, to understand with the live track, and we are able to see, to map, where is the minerals, where is the material, and to quantify them and to understand what is the coating, adhesion, and so on. On the tooth section also, in the tooth, we are able to understand, for example, the crystallinity, the hydroxyapatite, where is the crystallinity, and so on. So this is also another application we are working with. So this technique also, it's possible combined with theirs. This is, let's say, very hot topic at the moment. So a lot of people interested on theirs. It's quite important because we are able to decrease the optical resolution of the and also increase the signal. This is mainly the two reasons that the people want to measure or to use theirs, because want to reduce the resolution, because the optical system, its resolution is less than one micro or 0.5 micro. But with this, we are able to measure, let's say, on nanometer scale and with very, very, very weak signals. So here it's, for example, the theirs experiment using the to see the RNA to different places and identify different, let's say, the composition on the RNA. So also it's possible to combine the RAMA with nano indentation. It's quite useful for people that is studying the, let's say, the model, the elastic models, or what is kind of, let's say, chemical identification and also, let's say, mechanical properties, also from RAMA with SEM. So this is a combination between SEM and RAMA. So it's possible to combine these two in these machines as well. So, and this is the systems. We have three platforms available, the Contour, NVIDIA, and NVIDIA. This is automation. This is less automation, more automation, and much more automation. So it's depending of the, let's say, the purpose. We have different kind of platforms that are able to make. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Juan, for your nice talk.